Hello, Lancaster Hi-Fi here. So I recently put the Pioneer SX-440 in my son's room.
This is the Pioneer SX-440, and it can deliver about 12 watts per channel.
This is a 1970 Pioneer SX-440. I'm going to plug this in and give it a try.
And at first it sounded great. Then last night he noticed some static coming out of the left speaker, and I went up there with him today, and there was a lot of static coming out of both speakers. Not good. My first suspicion was transistors. These old units have the cheap plastic transistors, and those can fail. And they're known to throw a bit of static, but it seemed a little odd that the problem was sort of so simultaneous and out of both speakers. Anyway, I did do a bunch of looking into transistors and what I would use to replace the transistors that are in that machine. But before I actually got into replacing them, I decided, I better look at what's going on. Looked at the schematic, and the output is capacitor coupled. If those capacitors have gone bad, which now, it might be this is a receiver made in 1970. Well, then that could cause some bad sound out of the speakers. And I've noticed that when I turn this on, it does thump a bit, and that's not the greatest indication of proper performance. But not too awfully unusual in these really old receivers that don't have protection relays. Anyway, kind of learn from AH fix it, check the voltage on the speaker outputs. See if you've got DC voltage. So check it out. I've taken off the case, I've taken off the bottom, and I've taken off the front panel. Right now I've got the probes for the voltmeter on the speaker outputs. I actually got one on the chassis, but that's fine. And I'm going to turn it on, and I'm going to show you what the output of the voltmeter looks like. Here we go. Yeah, shouldn't be like that. Shouldn't be like that at all. Now, what I did find, if I sit here and watch this for a long time, it'll gradually scoot down and down and down and down. And what happens when I turn it off? Yeah. I'm suspicious of these capacitors here. Those are the output capacitors. And it should be a relatively easy thing to check. I just take those out, put in some new ones. Or some salvaged ones, anyway, at this point, because I don't have new capacitors in that value. But I've got some here that measured pretty well, and a couple others that measured pretty well as well. Should be able to switch these in for those and see whether that fixes the problem. And hey, who knows? Maybe it'll be a simple, easy fix. Of course, getting components out isn't ever super easy, but simple anyway. We'll see. So I put in the new old capacitors, or the old new capacitors are reading on the positive terminal. Yeah. About 18 volts. That's one channel, and that's the other. And then on the negative terminal. So here, on the one channel, about 100 millivolts. That's acceptable. On the other, 3 volts. Not acceptable. I figured out the capacitors weren't the problem, so I put the original ones back in. And then pop, pop, after a bit. And before that, I was puzzled by, the outputs wouldn't go to 0 volts. Well, I put them in backwards. So yeah, pop, pop. So now those are toast. You can see the ends kind of blown out looking. Surprisingly, I mean, if you didn't know that they were damaged, you might not realize they were damaged by just by looking at them. Oh well, those were out of spec anyway. So I put these in. Now I'm just kind of waiting for the failure mode to come back because everything seems fine so far. I'm thinking the best way to invite the failure mode is to probably actually make it amplify sound. So I'm going to switch back to radio. I don't know if that's music or just static. Doesn't matter. It's something. And then in a bit, I can switch back to aux to see if any of the signal remains. As I'm sitting here waiting for this failure mode to reappear, I know that it took some time to appear in the first place. And the small transistors on the audio unit are pretty cheap and not so awfully hard to replace. I mean, basically everything's accessible right here. It'd be nice to be able to take the board out, but the pain in the ass part doesn't really warrant it, because it's not that hard. I mean, there's only one layer of boards here. So we've got the 2SC871, that's in the phono preamp. That's one of the sort of top 10 bad transistors. We can replace that with the KSC1845. The 2SC870s aren't necessarily in the top 10, but might as well replace them. We can replace those also with the KSC1845. The 2SC561, that's a PNP. It's complementary to these, to one of these 2SC734s. 2SC734s can be replaced with the KSA1815, and the 2SA561 can be replaced with the complement to the KSA1815, which is the KSA1015. This 2SC968, well, that's in the power supply unit. I mean, I could replace that with the KSC1008. But I probably won't, not unless I need to. The ones in the tuner, I don't want to bother with. And of course the main output transistors, I don't want to bother with those either. Might be tricky. I've only got a few of some of these. Here's the sort of my transistor inventory down here. So what am I showing? I'm showing you what, whether it's just an NPN or a PNP. Showing you the maximum voltage from collector to base, the maximum back voltage from emitter to base, the maximum current through the collector, the maximum power dissipation, the gain, and at what sort of current and voltage the gain is, and the cutoff frequency or bandwidth. So you can see for some of these, the KSA992 and KSC1845, for example, those are complementary. And I got 100 each of those. Similarly, the KSA708, KSC1008, those are complementary. I've got 100 each of those. But all the others, like the ones where I've only got 5 each, those are ones like the KSA1015 and KSA1815. I had to get those as samples from OnSemi. And then these ones at the bottom are like high power transistors. Only got 10 each of those. I do have 10 of the MPSA aux 6s. Couldn't get any of the MPSA 56s, which are the PNP complements, but I don't see using any of those anyway. Finding transistors has gotten really sketchy since COVID. I think I should have everything I need though. We'll see. Eh, crap. If I wanted to replace these, right, an NPN and a PNP, and my plan was to use an 1815 and a 1015. I'd want to gain match those. Might not be absolutely necessary to gain match them, but a really good idea nonetheless. Well, only having 5 each, and I have measured the gain of those that I have. The gains on the KSC1815 are all pretty much identical at 212, and the gains on the KSA1015s are all not bang on with each other, but similar, but none of them have the same gain as the 1815s. And so I should just not replace those, I don't think. And I should be looking out to order a bunch more. That's one reason to order a bunch of transistors at the same time, so that you have the capacity to match gains where it's needed. So I've taken out these transistors. These are 870s and 871s. They all have these black legs, which I've heard, but I'm not sure is symptomatic or indicative of problematic transistors. Nevertheless, I have replaced all of those with 1845s. And you can see some of the new welds. Gone through and inspected all the welds, all of the new ones, of course, but also the old ones. So I redid some welds down there. Of course, I did also replace these output capacitors, the coupling capacitors to the output, with these.
You might complain, well, yeah, you replaced those, but they didn't really need replacing. The old ones you put in backwards and destroyed, so you had to replace them. And I would note, however, these were quite far out of spec. They may not have been causing problems per se, but measured values of the capacitance on these were like 50% over. I think I measured something like 1500 microfarads on one or both of these. So quite far out of the plus or minus 20% that you would normally expect. Now, it's possible that these are plus 80, minus 20 spec, but they don't say that. If they don't say, I'm assuming that they're plus or minus 20%, therefore these were far out of spec and should have been replaced. Now, I'd rather replace them with brand new ones, but these ones are well within spec. Almost done. I haven't put the knobs back on, but I did put the tuning knob back on. I checked to see that the tuning was smooth, and it had a little rub, squeak, vibration and going on. So, use just a dab of 3-in-1 oil, put a drop on the end of this swab, which has a pointy end, dabbed a little bit of oil there, and that didn't quite do the trick, so dabbed a little bit of oil there as well. Well, before I did that on this side, I noticed it was a bit grimy, so I cleaned it a bit with the swab. As you can see, it has a pointy end. Put the oil on there, worked it, and then wiped off the excess with the swab itself. Now it appears to be nice and smooth all across the dial range. I also gave this plastic faceplate a good cleaning front and back, first with the Mrs. Myers and then kind of buffed it with a microfiber towel. Last thing I did was buff the case just a bit with the microfiber towel. It has a Briwax finish, so it responds well to buffing. Shines it up nicely. Before I turn it on, I want to review my expectations of whether I might have actually fixed this thing. Notice I didn't really do any particular diagnostic work on this. I did not go about tracking down the source of the static and noise. Rather, I tried a couple of fixes, one which was aborted, and the other which was somewhat speculative, based on experience with these old pioneers, that they tend to throw static due to the old faulty transistors. I had that same issue with the Pioneer SX-828. It threw terrible static. I simply went in and replaced all the small transistors, and that fixed it up nicely. So I'm hopeful that replacing those black-legged transistors in this unit will do the same thing. Now, I didn't do any transistor replacement in the tuner, rather only the amplifier or audio unit. So let's just see what we've got. See, I'll put it on the... So far so good, but let's remember that it took some time for the fault to appear previously. At least we know we now have a functioning unit, that I didn't destroy it. The radio works, the audio unit works. Oh, certainly have to keep an ear on it. But so far so good, the repair seems to have been successful. So what did we learn? When it comes to relatively inexpensive parts that you have on hand, such as small transistors, and where small transistors are known to cause certain sorts of problems when they fail, and when small transistors are known to fail, or suspected of failure, sometimes the best course of action is simply to replace the inexpensive parts and see whether that works. Because you haven't really lost anything. You've replaced some old parts with good new ones. And you haven't spent a whole lot of time trying to chase down some phantom intermittent failure. We, of course, run the risk that the failure is still there, but still intermittent, and may reappear. But again, we haven't really lost anything because we've put in better new parts.
Spin the wheel.